when Helen is not on her public errands, she's at Arcan Ridge, a Connecticut house built for her by friends, so that she and Polly might have the security of a roof and walls of their own. Mornings at Arcan Ridge begin around 5. For Helen, they begin as they end, with the Bible. The heavens declare the glory of God, and the firmament showeth his handiwork. Day unto day uttereth speech, and night unto night showeth knowledge. There is no speech nor language where their voice is not heard. Polly, meanwhile, is brought up to breakfast. Sometimes something is missing from the tray. Then it is Helen who goes downstairs to fetch it. Polly knows that it pleases Helen to wait upon her when she can. Everywhere else, except in her own familiar house, it is Helen who must be waited upon by Polly. Here, where every table, every chair, every dish in the cupboard is her intimate friend, Helen can move freely and independently. Though in this quiet house, Polly need not speak aloud to Helen, she usually does. It helps to drive back the silence. First concern of the day is always the weather, to know how to dress for the morning walk with her dog, Etty.
Clear, but cold. She checks with her Braille thermometer. She is right. In her dressing, Helen is completely independent. She knows her clothes and where to find them, even to a stray belt. Every morning, Helen goes for a walk along a 1,000-foot handrail built by a loving friend to guide her. 1,000 feet, where she is alone and free. The walk seldom varies, but for Helen, it is always full of small, unexpected events. Helen is known from childhood with those with sight cannot realize that one does not need eyes to see the world. The patch of herbs that was here last summer is gone. By 8 o'clock, Helen and Polly have made their beds. Polly has finished the household tasks, and their business of the day begins. Even at home, they carry the responsibilities and obligations of public figures. Their desk is never clear. The mail piles up while they are away, and every morning more comes in. The bulky packages are books in Braille. They must wait. The letters will be gone through after Polly finishes spelling out the morning headlines. Helen is emphatic about keeping in touch with world events. But the mail looms large. A few of the letters are personal ones from friends. But most of them are requests for something. From New Zealand.
Would you kindly send a message to the Royal Blind Institute on the occasion of that?
From Massachusetts.
I have written a pamphlet on teaching the deaf. Please read it and let me have your comment.
From India.
I am going slowly blind. In the United States is a cure. Can you help me?
From New York.
I have chosen you as the subject of my term paper. Would you write me a long letter telling me all about yourself?
After the mail, Helen goes to her own study to work. There are reports to be made out, speeches and articles to be prepared. So far as possible, she does her own research. She locates her reference books by the Braille lettering along the edge. In her work, she will not indulge herself because she is handicapped. Everyone has his own handicaps, Helen says. It just happens to be the handicap of the blind that they cannot see, of the deaf that they cannot hear. She does her own typing. Her speeches she does on her Braille typewriter, so she can go over them herself for correction. The machine has only six keys because all Braille letters are made by the combination and placement of six raised dots. For her letters, she uses a regular typewriter. She is fast and accurate. But she has Polly check her letters. Being blind, she cannot permit herself casual mistakes of the seeing. If there are mistakes, Helen types the letter again. Vibrations of a buzzer, Helen knows when it is time for lunch. The glint of crystals is the one thing Helen thinks she remembers seeing as a baby before she went blind. Among her greatest pleasures. Helen's home is not a sad place because she is not a sad woman. She's extraordinarily gay. She goes toward each new experience with the joy of a child. On weekdays, there are only three for lunch. Helen and Polly and Anne, who comes in to help them with the housework. Their days are too full for social engagement. But at tea time, they relax and catch up with their personal mail. Friends may come in. may turn to politics or world affairs. Helen has strong views on these, and she has the courage to express them even when they are not popular. She also likes a good story and appreciates a joke as much as anyone else. So they spend their days when they're at home. Scarcely a week goes by that Helen's calendar doesn't call them away to a conference or a lecture. In this case, it is to a staff meeting of the American Foundation for the Blind, to which Helen is advisor and counselor. Today, the foundation is submitting for her approval a device for communicating with the deaf-blind and for enabling the deaf-blind to communicate with each other. The keyboard activates little metal prongs that speak directly to the fingertips in Braille. It is perhaps the most direct means yet invented of making contact with those who are both deaf and blind. Now, Helen types out, anyone can speak to us directly. Helen is interested in, partly responsible for, a great deal that is being done to find new ways of helping the handicapped. For the Dyker Street Nursery, they're experimenting with placing sightless children and seeing children together. It is important to accustom the blind to the give and take of normal, everyday life. At the Lexington School for the Deaf, she watches children at play. Today they have a new game. From blowing a piece of paper, they are learning to say who, what, when, why, like ordinary children. In class, she follows the progress of the older girls in learning to talk. Watching their struggles with speech, we can perhaps more easily understand why Helen says if she had a choice between her two afflictions, she would choose blindness. The deaf, cut off from the world both by lack of hearing and lack of speech, need all the encouragement she can give. But perhaps those to whom Helen gives her time most gladly are those who, like herself, are both deaf and blind. There are perhaps 25,000 of them in this country. And in the 50 years since Helen graduated from Radcliffe, there is only one other to have achieved a college degree, Robert Smithers of St. John's in Brooklyn. But they enjoy life and work like the rest of us. Their fortitude should make us perhaps recall, in respect to our own small difficulties, the truth spoken long ago. I cried because I had no shoes until I met a man who had no feet. The newly handicapped, the once whole young men who have come back from Korea disabled, these command as much attention from Helen as did their brothers in the Second World War. Then, as now, she and Polly tramp the endless corridors of our military hospitals, bringing hope to the amputees, the blind, and the disabled. Meeting Helen, seeing what she has made of her life, gives them more courage to reshape their own. For her services, she was cited at the close of World War II.
Then the leader of our armies, later the leader of the nation, Dwight D. Eisenhower, welcomed her to the White House and thanked her himself. Helen Helen Keller asked the president if she might have the privilege of seeing him. Afterwards, of his face, she said, I felt the courage and thought that carried him through such great years of the world's history. From a life lived mostly for others, Helen manages to save some part for herself. They are the necessary things, like shopping. The excitement of the city, its vibrations under her feet, she loves. She enjoys the labor of choosing and buying. She and Polly must shop with economy. But as they know it is part of Helen's job to look well in public, they must also shop with a great deal of care. And Helen's hats, back through the decades, are a minor footnote on the history of our times. Like our hats, the artist she has encountered also summarize an era. Joe Jefferson, when he played Lip and Winkle. Caruso, at the height of his fame. Ethel Barrymore, when she was in De Classe. Melchior as Siegfried. Benny Goodman at Carnegie Hall. Years ago, the young Heifetz played for her. Years later, Gladys Swarthout sings for her.
Beautiful. It is life, my dearest prayer.
That is beautiful. It is life, my dearest prayer.
When Helen takes time to relax, she is a merry companion. She is interested in everything and everybody. Spending an evening with Robert Helpman, the dancer, and Guthrie McClintock, the stage director, she seizes the opportunity to catch up with the amusement world. The theatre gives her full measure, for she reads a play before she goes to it. Dance forms she must feel, so Robert Helpman volunteers to show her the difference between classical ballet and the modern dance. Mr. McClintock does not feel that Mr. Helpman has made his point, and suggests that they take Helen to study some modern dancing at close range. Helen has been to Martha Graham's recitals, but this is the first time she's been to a company rehearsal in the studio. Polly must spell the action into Helen's hand. But she is aware of the rhythm and the movement of the dancers through the vibrations in the floor. As Martha Graham realizes, Helen's hands need not even touch the drums to feel intensely their vibrations. Thank you.
been to their performances in a theater. It is only in a rehearsal room like this that she is able to discover with her hands the line of body and limb that is the living pattern of the dance. Helen wanted to feel a lion. Annie Sullivan informed the zoo. A lion was fed. Helen entered the cage and felt the lion from its head to its tail. Obviously, Helen's sense of the world, its shapes, its texture, its form, comes to her through her sense of touch. But her knowledge of the world comes to her through books. And for books, she's indebted, as are all the world's sightless, to a blind Frenchman, Louis Braille, by whose invention the blind of all nations can read. It was to honor his memory that Helen, in 1952, went to France. At the Paris office of the Foundation for the Blind, she writes in French the address she is to give on the 100th anniversary of his death. A notre manière, in our way, we, the blind, are as indebted to Louis Braille as mankind is to Gutenberg. Helen's speech is only a part of the world's tribute to a great man. Today, 100 years after his death, he's being taken from the little village where he lived to lie for the rest of time in the Pantheon, the burial place of Francis Great. Behind his coffin marks the blind of Paris. Later, at the Sorbonne, Helen Keller delivers the address in his honor.
À notre manière, nous, les aveugles, sommes autant redevables à Louis Braille que l'espèce humaine l'est à Gutenberg.
Afterward, Helen Keller, Louis Braille's great disciple, is made Chevalier of the Legion of Honor.
Nous vous faisons Chevalier de la Légion d'honneur.
Then, from time to time, there is home again, where they sit among familiar things with curtains drawn, and are simply old friends. There is peace and quiet. There is music. So the dishes to be washed. As Polly washes the dishes, Helen shells pecans. Thank you.
Helen keeps a careful check on Polly. But when the radio is playing, it is hard to keep Helen's hand on her work. Then there is bed. This, then, is the message which we have heard of him and declare unto you, that God is light, and in him is no darkness at all.